Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Homage to the blessed, noble, and perfectly enlightened one. Namo sadhanto sujedoye alahadi samyau sambutoche.
Namo sadhanto sujedoye alahadi samyau sambutoche.
Together. O sang sen sen wei miao fa, bai qian wan jie nan zao yu. 我今见闻得受持, 愿解如来真实义. The unsurpassed, deep, profound, subtle, wonderful Dharma in 100,000 million eons is difficult to encounter. Now that I've come to receive and hold it within my sight and hearing, I vow to fathom the thus come one's true an actual meaning. Okay, good evening, everybody. Today is April 11th, 2015. We're here in Berkeley Buddhist Monastery, about to start the Avatamsaka Sutra lecture, also known as the Flower Garden Sutra. So I believe all of you have a sutra text in front of you. Looks like this. And on the front, there's a cover, and it says, Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yin Jing Hua Yin Hai Hui Fo Pu Sa. So I invite everybody to please recite with me. We'll recite the name 7 times of the sutra, as well as the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. And this is a chance to invoke their names. You could say inviting their presence. Oftentimes, when we greet somebody to our home, we invite them, we call their name. This is a chance to do that with the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. Oh, sorry. Okay. Namo da fang guang po wa yen jing wa yen nai wei po bu zai. Namo da fang guang po wa yen jing. Wang bo wa yin jing wa yin nai wei bo bu zai na mo da bang wang bo wa yin jing wa yin nai wei bo bu zai na mo da bang wang bo wa yin jing wa yin ai wei bo bu zai na mo da bang wang bo wa yin jing wa yin ai wei bo bu zai na mo da bang wang bo wa yin jing wa yin ai wei. Okay, all Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, Venerable Master, Dharma Masters, and all fellow cultivators in the way. Tonight we are beginning to lecture the Avatamsaka Sutra, and so I invite everyone to turn their sutra text to page, or open their sutra text to page 34 and 35. We're right now on the chapter called the 10 Grounds of the Avatamsaka Sutra, which describes the Bodhisattva's cultivation, and right now we're on the 6th ground. And we've just finished the prose section, and now we're entering the verse. And the verses, you could say, are a summary of what has been discussed before. So this is something that hopefully for most people who've been coming to our lectures isn't completely new. It's something that people hopefully remember. I was talking with Jing Fo Shi before about preparing for the lectures that what we should really do is give a test to see if people actually remember anything that we said. if we just passed around a little sheet and said, can you list the 12 conditioned links? And then when we'll talk about tonight, it says, can you explain where the past karma starts, where is the present, and where is the future? Where is the 12 links that are associated with the past? When is it the present, and when is the future? I think that would just be the only test question, to see if people could just remember that much. So maybe next time we lecture, we might test people, so maybe you try to remember. I don't know if that's ever been done before, but I think that would be a really valuable, you could say marker, a very valuable way to see, because we've gone over the 12 conditioned links now, I don't know how many times, probably 15, 20 times now, from different monks, different nuns, different people, all explaining it in different ways. One night we even had the PowerPoint slide with, you know, all the various images. So hopefully the idea is that it will sink into our brain. And the idea is that first step is called conceptual or literary prajna. Literally, it's translated. It's basically you understand it, right? We study the sutras and we go, okay, that makes sense. I understand it. So sometimes often a memory, you remember it, you retain it. So that's the first step. But then the Dharma has to go to the second step, which is you have to contemplate it. You have to reflect on it. You have to try to apply it and see if it works. That's the second step. So it's actually really important because the Dharma is not just something that we just, you can say, listen to, read, learn, and say, oh, I learned it. I've got it. I know it. Done. It's something that you have to take this next step, which is to actually reflect on it. And by reflecting on it is the third step, is when we actually realize it. They call it the true mark prajna, when we actually see it for ourselves. That's the line in Buddhism that the Buddha says, see it for yourselves in the here and now, right now in your life, to see if you can understand these principles. This is not just something we want to, you could say, take it on faith, say, okay, the Buddha said it, therefore I believe it, done. The Buddha said, I explain it, and we have a trust in the Buddha is explaining to us from his wisdom of what he's seen. And he says, I've seen it, you should see it too. So he's encouraging us to see how these work in our lives. So at least we can see if we got the first step done. If we even got the literary prajna part in people's minds, is if you could remember the 12 conditioned links and where the past, present, and future begin. I think that would be a very useful dharma for people in your lives, if you can have it in your hearts and then look about how you could apply it in your daily life, in your experiences in the world. Because that's what the dharma is for. It's for explaining our lives to ourselves so that we can find a way out of suffering. So this is a very, very important teaching. The 12 conditioned links is, you could say, pivotal, central to not just the Avatamsaka Sutra, but much of the Pali Canon talks about the 12 conditioned links. Many of the other sutras have the 12 conditioned links very, very central because it's such an important teaching. So right now we're going to be, you could say, reviewing in a way by going over the verses. But as we mentioned before, the Dharma is worth repeating. It just goes deeper and deeper every time we study it. And so if people can listen, and I encourage people to see if you could remember it, and if you could really remember it, and then really apply it. So that's what we're trying tonight to do, is to make it come alive for people, to see if we can help you apply a little bit of it so that later you can use it in your life. Okay, so we're on page 34 and 35. Let's see if Jing Fo Shi would like to say anything. Okay.
今天晚上，这里是金浦，跟大家结法缘。管理我们现在是在第六地的最后面的金刚藏菩萨崇颂的部分。那他这个也是等于一个呼吸。刚才金川师讲的，就是说。 最重要还是学习佛法，要就是要能够运用在生活上，这个最重要的。而且要运用在生活上，就是你要修行，就是要能够深入，像我们讲的深入经藏，那你就有智慧，甚至于久了以后。 智慧如海，这个就是我们常常讲的这个三皈依里面的。那当然，我们也一直讲了这个十二因缘，也讲了很多次了。那我也跟金禅师在讨论说，既然讲那么多了，是不是还要再继续讲这个经文上的，或者是我们可以。 改变其他的方式，但是我想，这个我们以后看怎样子做法。最重要就是要给大家能够精进修行的目的。So,
we're on the 10 grounds of the Avatamsaka Sutra, and this section, Vajra Treasury Bodhisattva is restating the sutra prose section in verse. You could say, saying it again. And so, as we mentioned before, the principle of the sutras is to actually cultivate it, to put into practice, to put into apply in our lives. Then we want to first deeply enter the sutra treasury, to deeply enter the Dharma, and then from there we will become have wisdom like the sea, just like we always recite in the three refuges. So we've gone over the 12 links of dependent origination many, many times. And so in our discussions with the Dharma, the prepare, I thought, well, maybe we should change our method in terms of how we would do the sutra lecture, but we still need to investigate it. Because we thought maybe the aim is still for people to really digest the Dharma and have it make sense. I could just share what Jing Forsher's idea was actually. Jing Forsher's idea was, let's have some of the lay people come up and explain it. I said, wow, okay, that's a good idea. So who knows, maybe a couple of weeks from now you're going to have to explain, okay, so what's the 12 condition links on the spot? So maybe you should go back and review.
其实练习想法，星空上人在的时候，他也非常重视。他你不上来讲，他甚至都跪下来，就要请你讲。 这个不只是法师，他有时候也会，就随便叫一个居士，或者是就是要训练讲法，这样子哦，这样子会自己会警惕自己，也会有精进，这样子很好。那这个我们等以后再讲。我们今天晚上我们从34页开始，我们想晚上进行就是。 寄送很好，所以金刚藏菩萨的寄送真的，我们佛典上的这个寄送都是值得我们能够去读。除了说它句子的结构、文字的结构很美以外，它还有可以给我们修行，这个是真的很好的。我们可以多读，常常去读它，觉得很好。像那个。那个谁，弘一大师，他就专门写毛笔字，写了一本专门是华严经的寄诵。这个就是一个很好的一个修行方式，也是提醒自己能够多进入佛法这样子。所以我们等一下就先念，我们从寄诵第34页念一遍，然后英文念一遍，这样子来。
Okay, so this the idea of practicing you know, practicing speaking Dharma. How you would say that in English? You're practicing how to do public speaking, but using Dharma. You could say Dharma, speaking, explaining Buddhism to everybody, is a really good way for people to cultivate, because it forces you to understand it better when you have to explain it to other people. And this is something that a venerable master, Master Hua, our founder, really encouraged for everybody. In fact, he even knelt in front of his disciples, asking him to speak Dharma, because at one point they were all, you could say, a little bit tentative. And it wasn't just monastics. He often sometimes would call a layperson just from the audience, like, oh, you should speak. And then they'd have to come up and say something. And so this trained people to learn to speak Dharma. But what this does is it helps you become more vigorous, become more, you can say, you pay more attention to your cultivation, because you also have to share the Dharma. So we'll see about the future if we will be using something like that for people to join in. Although I don't know if I'll scare people away. So, however, the sutra text right now, we're on Vajra Treasury Bodhisattva's verses, and these verses are very, very good. And when we read them, they're very helpful because they explain Dharma principle, and they're also very elegant in their use of language, especially in the Chinese. You see the verses are really elegantly written. In the English, we're beginning to get there. I know some people have very poetic and abilities and are making the verses also very poetic. So the principle, though, is that we want to cultivate it. And great master Hong Yi, he was a Vinaya master of modern times. He had very good calligraphy. And so what he did was he wrote out all the Avatamsaka verses in calligraphy. That's his practice. And so this is really good. This is one way to practice. This allows us to more deeply enter the sutras and study the Dharma. So what we're on is page 34. We'll read the Chinese and then we'll read the English. 34 and page 35.
这样子我们要节省时间，我们大家一起念就可以了。大家一起念。So read it together.
Yeah. So to save some time. So we're reading. If the people who don't speak Chinese, it's the pronunciation is below. And so you can just follow along and practice Chinese if you're not a good Chinese speaker. My pronunciation is not very good, so I'll let King Forsher lead it.
好,大家一起念,从第一行,了达三界一心有,十二因缘已忽然,生死皆由心所作,心若灭则生死尽。好,英文。
Next page. He understands that the three realms exist based on the mind, and that the 12 causal conditions are also the same way, that birth and death are brought about all because of mind, and that the mind's extinguished, birth and death will end.
Chinese? Okay. 无名所作有二种,言中不了为行因, 如是乃至老中梦,从此苦生无有尽.
There are two kinds of karma which ignorance enacts, not understanding that whereby one is supported and providing activities cause. It continues in that way up to old age and death. From this comes suffering which does not have an end.
Okay. 无名为言不可断，鼻眼肉尽习皆灭，疑思爱起烦恼之，行有事业疑皆苦。
With ignorance as the conditions, this cannot be cut off. Once that condition is ended, it all becomes extinguished. The limbs of affliction are stupidity, love, and grasping. Activities and existence are karma, and all the rest is suffering.
此至六次是行苦，触受增长是苦苦，所以有之是坏苦，若见无我三苦灭。
Stupidity up to the six locations is the suffering of process. The increase of contact and feeling is the suffering of suffering. The remaining limbs are all the suffering of decay. If one sees there is no self, the three sufferings are extinguished.
Okay. 最后，无名以行为过去，四智以受现在转。 爱取有生未来苦，观待若断边际尽。
Ignorance and activities pertain to what is past. Consciousness up to feeling happen in the present. Love, grasping, existence, and birth are suffering in the future. Observing awaited severance of suffering brings their boundaries to an end.
好，我想我们也稍微解释，当然这个解释你可以解释得很多很多很深，但是我想，依照摩诘的这个智慧，只能够浅浅的谈一谈，就是很简单的谈一谈，那像了达三界一心有。 这个就是要我们能够，当然就是讲到修行，希望我们能够明了三界，都是心里面所造作的。然后像这个三界，讲起来就是受戒，就是一戒，像我们都是在一戒，然后就受戒、无受戒，就是一戒最低的。 像我们这个一般的娑婆世界，这个都是一界，包括那个六一天，这个都是一界。然后受戒就更高了，受戒还有一点点身体，无受戒它就完全是没有身体的这个存在了，这样子只有事在心在那这样子。
So this Dharma, you could say, if you want to explain it very deeply, you could explain it very deeply and very profoundly, or it can be very straightforward and simple. Based on my wisdom, which isn't very much, actually I didn't make a comment. When I'm translating for Jing Foshir, I use the personal pronoun. I'm talking about actually Jing Foshir. Yesterday, last time, Jing Foshir gave a story about him. His daughter already got a PhD and for one of the audience members came in and told somebody else, "Wow, he doesn't look that old. He has a daughter that has a PhD." So when I'm translating, when the first person were Jing Foshir, so I don't have anybody who's I don't have any family in that way. Okay, anyways, so given my wisdom is very shallow, I can just give a very surface explanation for the Dharma so that people can understand it. And so the first one, it says, he understands that the three realms exist based on the mind. This is something that we talk about, which is that we want to be able to understand what the three realms are and how they all come from this mind of ours. And so, if people know the three realms, the first one is the desire realm, is sometimes in Sanskrit the kama loka, the form realm, the rupa loka, and the formless realm, the arupa loka. And these three realms make up our existence, what we understand in samsara, and we cycle through them. So how it's described is that we're actually in this desire realm, the kama loka. This realm is basically where human beings are, as well as there's six heavens, this kind of heavenly realms that are considered still within the desire realm. They still have desire. Then after that, there's another, there's more higher heavens, which in those heavens, the beings there, the devas or celestial beings there, they have, you could say, a more subtle body. They don't have desire. They have this more subtle body. And then finally, in the formless realm, they don't have a body at all, but they just have pure consciousness. And so these are the three realms that we as living beings cycle through. We go into these different realms and we come back.
所以这个我们有这个心，就是以上的一切都是由我们心所造成的。所以这个我们有这个心，就是以这就会造成一直像三界里面，三界就是还没有出，所以我们一直要讲要出三界。这个三界都是在里面，那这个都是讲这个心。那像在如来寺有一句偈颂，就是无心道人以佛起，所以我们就是要修到无心，这个是很重要的。
So, the sixth ground bodhisattva cultivates understands and cultivates these 12 conditioned links. And so he or she develops wisdom and from there can see how from this mind of ours we can give rise to the three realms of existence. And so in Buddhism we often talk about what we're trying to do is to be able to transcend and leave these three realms behind. So where we do that is we must look at our mind. In Tathagata Monastery, we call TM, in the city of 10,000 Buddhas where the monks live, there's a verse on the wall. And one line says, the cultivator who is free of a mind close to the Buddhas, is close to the Buddhas. And the idea of being say free of the mind or not having a mind is that we no longer have our false mind. We're no longer constantly thinking confused thoughts and doing confused things. But we're completely free and unattached. And by doing that, we be drawn near to the Buddhas.
So, so因缘就是会产生，也就是我们有心，一切唯心造，就是一个很重要。 甚至于万法也是唯心造，所以会产生我们生死轮转，就是我们有一个心，这个心是妄心，这个不是清净心。那佛菩萨他们是清净心，那我们常常在谈心佛众生都是平等的，所以我们就是可以用修心。 来修这个心，来达到成佛，这样子就是一个修，讲起来还是一样的，修行就是修心。So
the 12 conditioned links, as well as says that it all comes from the mind, and also it's said that the 10,000 or the myriad things, everything that we know, all the phenomena also come from our mind. It's our mind that causes samsara to continue on, the cycle of death and rebirth. But this is our false mind. You could say this mind that is illusory and confused. It's not the pure mind. It's not pure. The Buddhas and Bodhisattvas have a mind that are pure. So we often talk about how the mind, the Buddhas, and living beings are all, you could say, equal and level. But what we need to do is cultivate our mind so that we can become a Buddha. We need to be able to cultivate, and then one day we can become a Buddha.
又话又讲回来，要修到无心，那这个无心，然后我们又要有心去修，然后他修到无心，无心我想解释应该是没有妄心，没有执着心，没有攀缘心。 哦，就这样子的一个讲的无心。那，在以前古时候有一个讲一个就是白居易啊，他去 他也是很喜欢佛法，所以他也去问过一个法师，他这个是一个禅师，他名字就是叫做维宽禅师，那他是一个禅师，那他就问禅师说你是怎么样子来跟众生说法， 然后那个禅师啊，维宽禅师就跟他讲，这个无上的菩提啊，身体力行就是戒律，就是当他问法师啊，就是说我们修行就是要戒律，去力行戒律，然后口说出来。 用口说出来就是佛法，哦，就是说你有修行戒律，然后你口说出来就是一个佛法，就是说法，然后你心用去领悟，这个就是禅悟，修禅的起悟的，所以这个就是好像。 大江的水啊，跟湖泊的水都是一样，水性都是没有两样的。那你又何必要去再去问这个事情呢？就是说，你讲起来，我们佛法就是很直接了当的，直心直口出来，这个就是一个佛说法，一个佛法。So
this principle of not having a mind, of having this free from a mind, wuxing, maybe needs a little bit more explanations. And so what I would maybe explain it as is, this is talking about not having the false mind, not having the kind of discriminating mind that's always confused, not having an attachment, this mind that goes out and attaches to things. And also, we could literally translate as climbing on conditions. You could say the mind that looks for advantages for itself. You know, I think it's a very concrete experience. I don't know if people can actually come up with a really good translation for that idea. It'd be a really good, a good skillful means. But it's that kind of mind that manipulates the world for its own advantage. And I think we all know that mind very well. It's like we go to something and we go, oh, if I can just change these conditions, it'll be really comfortable for myself. And it's so quick in the mind. And so that mind is, in Buddhism, is seen as the kind of selfish, confused mind, and we don't want to follow it. And a lot of the cultivation is trying to reduce it and ultimately let it go entirely, because that's the mind that actually creates a lot of suffering for ourselves and other people. So anyway, so that's the pan yuan xing, this mind that climbs on condition. You have an idea? Cleverness? Vafeta suggests the word cleverness, this clever mind. Being clever, yeah? It could be being clever. Not quite there. Yeah, there's kind of the meaning. Yeah. Yeah, clever. In the world, we actually often praise cleverness, I think, in modern society, actually in a little bit the manipulative way, in the sense that that's how we get ahead, you know, in the sense of going out in the world and getting ahead. And I think it's something that if we really looked at in our own hearts, we actually never really get ahead. We actually always end up losing out. And there was just last Tuesday, Ajahn Pasano came to speak Dharma here. It was the Abhayagiri monks are now doing their Tuesday nights again, here once a month on the first Tuesday, so at tea time. And somebody was asking him about Dharma questions. So tea time is very informal because it's the monks are in front and everybody's drinking some tea and then people just ask questions. So it's very informal. So people were asking questions. One person was talking about having a crisis of faith in Dharma practice and what to do. And so one of the responses that I thought Ajahn Pasano gave, which was really good, connected with this idea of climbing on conditions. He said, there's a really good quote from Ajahn Sumedho that he really liked. And he said, it goes like this. Whenever I think of myself, I'm depressed. Huh, that's a good quote. Because whenever we think of ourselves, we get depressed, which is because we're thinking of ourselves. So the idea with Buddhism is we don't want to have that self. We don't want to have that mind that's climbing and trying to find an advantage, because that mind ends up leading us astray. Master Hua often talked about it a lot. We have the sixth great principle is not pursuing personal advantage. He really emphasized that as important for spiritual cultivation, because if we don't get that principle right, we can actually end up using the Dharma wrong. You know, we take the Dharma for getting kind of a position or setting up an identity or for, you know, whatever we do because of our mind that climbs on conditions. But that mind, I think, for people to really pay attention to that, because that's really encouraged, I think, in a kind of modern society, or I think it's any society, that mind is generally not really pointed out and said, that's the trouble. That's the trouble. Usually that's seen as, you know, you think that's who we are and that we try to feed that mind. But that mind is actually the one that's causing us a lot of problems. So the cultivation is about reducing that. As you can probably tell, the translation is a double translation. When I talked with Jing Foshir, the idea was, and he gave explanation, and I would kind of add some things to it. So part of that was definitely my addition. So yeah, but the story that Jing Foshir was saying was about, it came from a Chinese culture, and it's a Chan story, a story that a person named Bai Jingyi. Which I don't know.
Bai Ji Yi.
他是一个宰相吗？还是不是？不是。
No.
Okay. Some person named Bai Ji Yi.
他做很多诗。
Oh, he's a poet. He's a literati. He's a poet, and
后来他成就佛法也蛮不错的。
He also had quite a lot of success in his spiritual practice and cultivation in the Dharma. So he was a poet, and so he went and asked a Chan master named Wei Quan禅师. So Chan Master Wei Quan, and he asked about Chan Master Wei Quan, how do you speak Dharma for living beings? And the Chan Master's reply to him was, the unsurpassed Bodhi is just making your body upright and proper. And that's the vinaya. The mouth that just speaks, you know, you just speak, that's the Dharma. And the mind is awakening, that's Chan. That's the awakening of Chan. It says, the river, the water in the river and the water that you boil, they're not two things, they're the same. Why do you make a difference? And so this is the Chan Master's response, very direct and to the point.
Okay. Yeah. 像他就是说你何必要去分别那些有分别心呢? 那白居易又问了，那没有分别，又怎么修心呢？要怎么去修行修心呢？你修行修心都是分别里面去修，那这个禅师又讲了，你的心本来也没有什么受伤，你为何不要去修它呢？本来都是清净，都是完好的，你何必要去修它呢？ 那白居易又讲了，就是说，假如说你不去修心，那不是跟一般的凡夫都是一样的吗？那这个禅师他又解释这样子，他凡夫啊，他愚昧，他是无明，那二乘的人啊，他是执着，他很执着。 在某一些方面，所以他执着他自己的修行，就是二乘的。那能够克服这两种啊，就是你自己能够克服无明，就现在我们现在一直在谈这个无明，能够克服这两种，那才是真正的修行，就是真修。所以真修的人，就是说不要有常常。 就是妄念妄动啊，妄在那里分别啊，这个是很重要的一点。其实这个都是妄心，这个不是真心，都是妄心。所以为什么就是要修到无心？无心就是清净心，就是没有执着心，没有什么那个。
So So the Chan Master then told Baiji, he said, so why do you discriminate so much? Why do you discriminate so much? And so this literati, Baiji, says, well, if you don't discriminate, how do you cultivate? In our cultivation, we need to discriminate. How do we know what to do? And the Chan Master's reply to him, back to him, was, your mind never needed to be cultivated in the first place. Or you could say, show, has another meaning. I think it's like repair, you know, like you repair a car. You know, just your mind never had to get repaired in the first place. It's perfectly fine. Why do you need to fix it? And so Baiji said, well, if we don't repair it, aren't we just like an ordinary living being? You know, aren't we just confused like everybody else? And so Chan Master reply was, living beings live in ignorance, while those who cultivate the, you could say the lesser vehicles, that of just becoming an arhat or a Pratyeka Buddha, not walking the bodhisattva path, they get attached to their own cultivation. You know, they're still attached in certain ways. But if you can subdue and both of these things and don't follow them, then you can really truly cultivate, then it's true cultivation. So for ourselves, we want to cultivate in a way that we don't always give rise to discriminations. Because whenever we discriminate, that's our false mind. It's not cultivating from our you could say, mind, our being free of a mind.
Okay.
Yeah.
好，我们再看另外一个偈颂， 无名所作有两种， 言中不了， 为行因，日是乃至老终末，从此苦生无有尽。所以刚才就是讲到无明，就是因为我们都还没有破无明。那我们破了无明，就能够不会再做一些糊涂的事情。所以他这个偈颂中有讲到有两种。 无明啊，它后面就开始，因为有无明就有业因跟行因了，所以有两种因缘，两种因啊，它的因。然后你一有发生这样子，那你就一直在轮转，然后后面就接着，一直下去到老死，就是这样子。所以没有穷尽的。
So here we talk about the ignorance that creates two kinds of karma, and go on and on. I just want to point out, if people want to, you can look at page 12 and 13, the very bottom. This is the exact place that we're reviewing here. So it says, if you look on bottom 13, it says, there are two kinds of karma created by ignorance. The first kind confuses living beings about what is conditioned. And the second provides the cause for the rising of activities. So what people can get a sense of for the verses is that it makes the prose section much more succinct, so that if you want, for instance, if you memorize the verses, then all those principles we talked about, you know, all these probably 3-4 months will be, you know, in your mind, so that you remember the verse, you go remember the principle, because the verses are a lot easier to remember. So that's the principle over there. You guys want to point that out. But the karma creates the seeds for two things, the karma and this kind of ongoing activity. Or you say the next step in the 12 conditioned links is called xing, or samskaras, or activities, formations. Sometimes translated as karma. And so they just continue on, and they end all the way, they kind of go with the whole 12 conditioned links, and they end up with old age, sickness, death, suffering, lamentation, sorrow. There's a whole list of the sufferings that the Buddha gives that come from following the 12 conditioned links to its end. And so this cycle is endless. If we don't go and try to break the chains, the kind of the 12, kind of, you can see them, the chains that are all interconnected to each other. If we don't break it, then it's endless. We're just stuck in it all the time.
所以这个像，盐也很重要。像因为我们有 业因就是我们以前所做的业，然后像投生，就是我们上辈子所造的这个业，因为还没有断，然后这个种子在这个八十天里面，然后就碰到缘，就成熟，然后就开始就做了，就开始做，就发作，讲起来发作也可以，就好像。 发言一样，就一直下去这样子，然后这样，这个，所以所有的事情都是要有因缘具足，这个很重要，就是我们讲，这个缘，像我们今天大家在这里，听法也是要有具足，要有法师，然后也有各方面的软体、硬体，然后都有具足的。 最重要就是有来听法的这样子，这整个就记住这个。像 CCTV 它有一个法会，观音法会，现在晚上他们都是在，可能现在快要跑香了，还没有，还没有，等一下跑香，在跑西方极乐世界。那就是观音期也是要记住各方面啊，你要记住才能够成立一个法。 一个观音期法会，尤其是厨房也很辛苦。我所知道，法师在那一带也是很辛苦。这个就是一个缘都很重要。So
when we talk about the causes of karma, are these activities? These are things we do from our past, and we plant these seeds in our past lives, so that we end up. These seeds take root into the. Into our current life, and they arise, and we end up having this life. So they all mature when the conditions ripen. Okay, what might be useful is, because I know there's a couple people who are maybe completely new, and of the people who have been around all these 3 months, I don't know if people actually remember the 12 links. If I were to say the first one, ignorance, okay, ignorance, we just talked about that one. The second one, formations, okay, we already said that. The third one, consciousness, okay. Alan's got almost all of them. Consciousness, what's the fourth one? Name and form, very good. And fourth one, fifth one? Six senses, oh, wow, there you got one. Yeah, very good. Six? Contact, yeah. Six, contact, seven? Feeling. Eight? Craving, nine, I heard Mai said that. Nine is what? Grasping. 10, becoming or existence. Well, Alan, 10, 11. Birth, Jara, yeah. And then the last one, you just said it, Marana. Death, old age, sickness, death, lamentation, sorrow, and despair. That's what the Buddha says. He has a long list. He goes, and he actually defines them all, what each one is. You know, this is despair, this is suffering, this is anguish. So that's the 12 links. And this describes the process of our going from life to life. So for instance, when Jing Foshu just said that there's this cause of this ignorance and these kind of samskaras, these activities, these formations, they come into this life, when we came born in this life, with this consciousness kind of starts taking root and then starts growing, you know, starts growing and maturing. And we mature in our mother's womb, so we develop name and form, we develop the six senses, then we start coming into contact with things, and this whole reality that we create comes out of that. And so for things to happen, Jing Foshu was emphasizing how the conditions need to come together for something to happen. It's not just the cause, but also the supporting conditions come together. And when those come together, then something happens. So for instance, in this Dharma, this sutra lecture today, we have a couple of things that need to happen. One is there has to be a monastics here who are speaking, right, speaking the Dharma. And then we have to have all the place, you know, the environment. Very importantly, we have an audience to listen. We also have the online audience, and so that's, you need to have the software of the computer and the hardware of the camera. And we have all these conditions that need to come together for us to have this Dharma assembly. Also, today is the last day of the Guanyin session, the State of the Thousand Buddhas. They're about to do the great transference at 9 o'clock there. So right now I'm sure they're sharing their Guanyin session experiences with everybody. And so for that to happen also requires many conditions for it to occur. It's not just something that just happens, you know, spontaneously. There needs to be people working really hard in the background, to turns of the kitchen. I know the kitchen staff, the monastics there, and the lay people who are supporting there, they work really hard to make something happen. So all the supporting conditions make something happen.
So then
having all the conditions be there, present, for something to happen is very important. Master Hua has a verse that we recite before all the ceremony. It says, freezing to death, we do not scheme. Starving to death, we do not beg. Actually, the scheme is that word for panyuan. So one way we translate that word panyuan is scheming. So you need to get something, you want to scheme to figure out, well, what am I going to do to get the way I want things to be? So Master Hua was really firm. You know, his principle was rock solid, that regardless of the situation, he wouldn't go and scheme for an advantage, right? And so this is really important principle, because when the conditions aren't there for something to happen, we don't want to go and force it. We don't want to go and seek after something to get something that we want. Myself, I know in the past, I sometimes really wanted something, and if I don't get it and not successful, then I feel, you know, somehow discouraged or depressed or upset, a little bit like a lost hope. And so this is not skillful, because when the conditions aren't there for something to happen, we just should let it go. Don't force it. There's another line here that talks about old age and death. And something that I remember was that Taiwan, when we were growing up, there was the, he was a president?
Chiang Kai-shek's
president? Yeah, Chiang Kai-shek, who brought over, I think, he was 100,000soldiers to Taiwan. And at that time, he was thinking about going back to China to fight back. But the conditions never ripened for it. And so in the end, nothing ever happened. And so ended up all the soldiers end up just getting old, say the old age and death, is getting old and dying in Taiwan, because the conditions were never there. So you can see this is when the conditions aren't there, then something doesn't really happen.
Okay, 下面也是在讲, 又讲一个无名为言不可断, 皮眼苦尽习皆灭, 应受爱其烦恼之行, 行有事业已皆苦, 就是说你, 因为你没有断无有这个缘没有断, 就会产生很多的苦, 然后你断了, 那就没有就不再苦了。他后面还强调，就是愚痴，愚痴就是无明，然后爱取，所以这个爱取很重要，爱取就是产生烦恼的这个很重要的一个作为。其实爱讲起来，以我自己的刚。 没学佛以前，也是哦，爱很好啊，爱情啊各方面都觉得非常，都，表示说没有爱的话，就觉得好像失去什么东西，所以就很希望人家，我们也爱人家，人家也爱我们，包括我们的亲戚朋友都是一样的。 那其实讲起来哈，这个佛陀他也曾经讲过，有人去讲这个爱的一个，因为有人亲，有了他的亲戚死掉了以后，他很痛苦，那他就去问佛陀，然后佛陀就是说，因为有爱的关系，那那个人他不太同意。 他因为爱是很好，爱就是觉得非常，觉得才是真正的一个所需要的一个他佛陀的解释，因为你爱会产生很多烦恼，所以在我们修行内呢，所以我们真的要看淡，我们要把这个情要看淡。 看淡是般若，这个是一句名言。看淡是般若，包括我们现在也慢慢真的想体会到，出家以后真的体会到，你很多事情不要太执着，尤其是在亲情方面，包括朋友也是一样，真的要看淡，淡如水，君子之交淡如水，但是我们不说不关心，但是我们就是要关心，但是你这个关心的时候，你的心跟以前会不一样，出家的心那个会不太一样的，而且你学佛法的跟以前的这个心也会不一样，你了解到这个带来的麻烦，就是我们要非常。 要看淡这个事情。
Okay, so this next line goes, when ignorance as the condition, this cannot be cut off. And so if I were to translate it again, it's basically, if you have ignorance, then this whole 12 condition links we just described, it's going on and on and on and on. It doesn't end. It's endless. You don't break it. And so, but when you let go of that ignorance, when you cut off that ignorance, then it all extinguishes itself. The cycle stops because you broke the link. This next line goes, the limbs of affliction are stupidity, love, and grasping. So here, the Buddha particularly says that what are the afflictions? What causes the afflictions? Stupidity, which actually... I mean, there's three terms that we throw around. They're all kind of in the same ballpark. One word is called stupidity. Some people use that one. Some people don't like to use that one. Some people think that's kind of too mean to people because you say something stupid. It's a little bit too mean. But some people say, well, that's actually what it means. so there's stupidity. And then there's another word we use sometimes, delusion. You know, we don't see things clearly. We're kind of deluded. And the other one we have is ignorance. You know, we use ignorance here as well. So that's all the same idea. Stupidity, ignorance, delusion. Because basically, we don't understand. We just don't know what's going on. We say, you know, where did we come from before we were born? We don't know. Ignorance. Where are we going to go when we die? We don't know. That's ignorance. So the Buddha is pointing to this kind of fundamental not knowing, not understanding. And so because of that, then we just continue on this cycle endlessly. And so what are the seeds for all this confusion or this affliction is the stupidity. And the next one, which is love, which sometimes is translated as a kind of craving. So this word love is a very tricky one in English because love has so many different connotations. I think it has a lot of connotations in all languages. In Chinese, it's called ai. Jing Po Shi was just describing ai qing, which is kind of this loving affection. And so now we'll go back to translation. So he was saying in the past, with being a layperson and before learning the Dharma, not having love seemed to be a really bad thing. Somehow, if I didn't have love, it's like I was missing something. You know, missing out on life. Something's missing. And in society, we always want this kind of affectionate love of friends or other people. We always want this. And but actually, when you really look at it, when you really examine it, this kind of grasping love that's craving, seeking, is actually very painful. There was a person who came to see the Buddha, and whose relative just died, and who he loved very much, and it was very painful. And so he spoke with the Buddha, and the Buddha told him, "Well, your suffering is coming from your deep attachment to that person, your grasping, your craving, your love for them." And the person didn't quite agree because they thought, this is really what's important. This love is really what's important. That's what's part of life. But here in the Dharma, we learn the Dharma. We see actually love in this way actually creates affliction. And it's something that continues on and on, this affliction. So I'm just going to give some context because I think this is actually a really important concept here in the West. I don't know how many Westerners are in this room, but having grown up in the West, love is a really complicated idea because there's certain amounts that are actually, you could say, wholesome, this kind of care. So care for one another, this kind of attentiveness and care and compassion. So we use the word compassion in Buddhism. And so there's those elements in love that's actually wholesome. So what we usually translate this word love as is kind of this craving, this kind of, or sometimes there's also the sense of affection. Because when you really think about it, affection has this kind of sticky quality to it. And this is something I really didn't get until I got into Buddhism. We always start talking about stickiness. We talk about this other person. This person's really sticky. And what does that mean is that when they talk to you or they interact with you, you feel this kind of sucking, kind of like they're trying to like get you to glue to them almost. It's like they want something from you. If somebody who's trying to get you to buy something from them, who really wants you to like them or is like flattering you, or doing these kind of things, you feel this kind of energy coming from that person. That's kind of like a stickiness. It's like they're trying to grab you. So that's something that's actually, in Buddhism, seen as a cause for a lot of suffering. Why? Is because when we try to do that, when you get sticky, you stick to something, you attach to it, which is the next link, which is the talk about here, which is grasping. You stick to it, you hold on to it. But the problem is that the thing that you're holding on to is impermanent. It doesn't last forever, right? And so at one point that will go away, and when that goes away, there's a lot of pain. So it's just not a very skillful use of the mind. So in Jing Fo Shi was saying here, next one was saying, so in cultivation, one of the things we want to do is be able to see our relationships to be very plain. Then sometimes has a sense of kind of dull or like a light, L-I-G-H-T, light. I don't know about light, then. I mean, if you're talking about then, light meaning in flavor. So in that idea, is for instance, if you're eating soup, it has a very light flavor. It's a very plain flavor. It's like something like bland, see your relationship as very bland. Yeah, sounds very bad. So I wanted to explain it because simple. Well, there's actually the idea of bland. So Jing Foshu, it's like it's bland like water. And do you see the relationships are bland like water? That's really prajna. So what does that mean? Because I think most of us, we like to see our relationships as really like chili peppers or something, you know, red hot chili peppers. And so what's the principle there? So I'm going to give you a little bit of commentary. I think if you really look at it from the perspective of wisdom, actually you want to see all your relationships in this kind of very plain, equal, level, bland way. It's not exciting. I think that's something that's, when you come into the Dharma, at least for me, learning Buddhism, was something that I had to learn, was to not look for excitement. There's a kind of a different way to be in the world. And by not looking for excitement and actually looking to the blandness, you actually find a lot more solidity. Excitement is kind of, as I said, red hot chili peppers, right? Are you going to eat a meal of red hot chili peppers? If that's all you eat, I think you have a lot of suffering. I'm sorry to say. And I think if you see people whose relationships are all red hot chili peppers, their lives are a lot of pain, usually. You know, they're kind of excited about somebody or something, and then somehow that person doesn't turn out exactly the way that they all got excited about, which always happens. So they're suffering, and then such and such. But the people we take to be very bland, you know, like water that we drink every day, we need to survive, that end up being the people that we really can rely on. And so if we don't look to excitement, but we look to seeing what's the very simple things that we rely on, and that's the kind of relationships that we want to build, what we'll actually find is that we develop a very solid base. These are the people who will stick by us, whatever happens. They're just solid, you know, they're reliable. They're not, you know, they don't get emotional about something and leave us or hate us or do something. They're just steady and supportive. And so that changes our relationships at a very deep level. And so in a way that also changes us. So develop those kind of relationships requires us to actually see relationships in a different way. If we can see ourselves also caring for other people like water, you know, we're not doing anything over the top. You know, we're not, we just do the things we need to do so the other person can be supported and cared for. Then life is very smooth all the time. You know, life is very smooth. We get the sustenance that we need. We don't dehydrate. We don't have all the various, you could say, afflictions that come from doing too much, about grabbing on the things and holding on to them. Okay, so then Jing Foshu talks about, so for these friends and relatives we have, we don't want to end up really, you know, kind of getting all this kind of emotionally attached to them, but to see it as kind of bland and plain, like water. But this doesn't mean that we don't care. So this is actually really important. It's not to say that you deaden your senses. You don't, you say, okay, I'm being very bland, you know, and so therefore I just become very cold. That's not the spirit of the Dharma either. If you go to that extreme, you end up becoming kind of like a senseless, they say don't become like a senseless log, you know, don't become like a rock. You know, we're actually human beings, we're living beings. We're cultivating our nature, and there in this nature, there's a natural care for one another. It's not something that we have to add on to. But this kind of care is very different. It's not a care that comes from a stickiness. It's not a care that comes from a self, an identity. And so becoming a monastic, had an opportunity to experience this much more directly, this kind of relationship which is much more plain like water. And as we learn the Dharma, we'll see that our mindset changes. And we will, bit by bit, see how we let go of all the various problems that we have by looking at it very differently. Actually, I just want to add one more thing, because I actually just spent a lot of time writing a paper on friendships, The Buddha actually talks about spiritual friendships, especially for the monastics. And he says that actually one of the qualities of friendship is to develop the Eightfold Path. Or you could say cultivate the way, another way to say that, if people don't know the Eightfold Path. And he says it's based on seclusion, dispassion, cessation, and maturing in release, in the technical. Basically, it leads to liberation. But I wanted to talk about the first one, which was that it's actually based on seclusion, based on solitude. So I thought that was very interesting because it was basically friendship that was based on solitude. Because usually we think of friendship as a way to not be alone, right? We're friends so that we can feel a little bit like not lonely. We don't feel lonely. But the Buddha actually points out that friendship on the spiritual path isn't about finding friends so that we're not lonely, but we're on this path together to walk the way, to kind of cultivate the path, the Eightfold Path. And so rather than the image, so I really like this idea, rather than the image of two friends, you know, we're just spending time together and just hanging out, rather within the Dharma, we're all here together on this path. We're walking a path together. So we're traveling companions. If people who have a kind of a hiking, backpacking background, so you know, if you go on a 50-miler hike, you know, we're fellow backpackers, and we're walking in this path. And it's really helpful to have friends, you know, fellow traveling companions, because at some point you might realize you sprained your ankle, and so you need somebody to help you out, or you didn't bring enough water, so they're going to share some water for you, or maybe they have better sense of direction, so they tell you when you go off the path, right? And so the Buddha in the sutras actually really encouraged spiritual friendship, this kind of Dharma friends, helping us in our cultivation. But the friendship that he's encouraging there isn't a sticky friendship. It's a friendship of many, many people cultivating the path together, walking this path together, supporting one another. It's not the stickiness. And so I think that's a really important principle for our cultivation, this idea of not attaching to people, to not, you know, holding on to people in that way. Because I think in society, again, like I was just talking about the pan yuan xing, the mind that's scheming, I think only when you start coming into the Dharma do you hear principles like this. Usually this kind of love is really, you could say, the pinnacle of what we're trying to do, is trying to develop these kind of relationships. But the Buddha's not saying that, you know, that's, you could say, wrong. You know, he's not trying to judge somebody or looks down on somebody, but he's just describing experience and saying, why are you suffering? Why do you suffer from, you know, a lot of depression or feelings of loneliness? It's because you're actually craving affection. You're craving appreciation, you're craving that experience. And if you can let go of that experience, you'll let go of that suffering. That suffering will no longer arise. That's the seed. The effect of that is much later that you don't sometimes see, but that's the effect. So that's what I would say is a very important principle. I don't know if you want to show your video.
Or we can keep going. Go ahead, faster.
Okay. Yeah. 5 minutes. We will do that. Okay. Shows that your video too. King Fosher made a video of Highway 9. He's been really vigorous in the monastery down there. So, I think it probably be safer to show the video. Otherwise, people won't be going home. Won't be causing a lot of affliction.
Okay. We can video. So yeah, tonight we'll be here.
So just to give some context, there's another monastery, or do you have questions? Maybe first you have questions or reflections? I see somebody seems to be, okay. Yes.
I guess not having sticky relationships and, you know, having a bland relationship is more stable, but when you started talking about, you know, not seeking for excitement, I first thought about not in terms of relationship, but in terms of like personal, like alone time. You know, if I don't see excitement, then there comes boredom, right? And that's like going on the other side and not other side of the spectrum. And okay. So I guess like.
等一下，我们讲完再来。
Okay, yeah.
What I'm trying to ask is like, when I am aware that I'm seeking excitement, and I try to turn it down, you know, my energy down to not, you know, have it that, and you know, that exciting energy, right? Like boredom yeah. comes. So
boredom
I don't
comes.
Know how do I deal with boredom?
How do you deal with boredom? That's a really good question for modern times, because I think probably the thing that's the most scary for you know, myself as a young person and young people, I think in general now, is boredom. It's like, oh my goodness, I'm going to be stuck in a place, and if I don't have my cell phone, oh my goodness, life is over. I mean, it's going to be really boring. If you possibly do the sutra lecture and then don't have a cell phone and I just listen, I think they'd be really, really bored. They didn't want to be here. So that actually is a really important idea. And so I think there's a couple ways to look at it. If we want to look at it from the 12 conditioned links, what you will find is that the experience of boredom is actually a choice that we make in our mind. We actually have a choice that we can make of not getting bored. But there requires a certain amount of samadhi for that, a certain amount of training of the mind to be able to see that you have that decision. And that decision comes from basically when you seek or attach to excitement. So that's why we aren't looking for excitement as something that we hold up as really great in Buddhism, because what that creates, as you just described, is these experiences of boredom and depression. I think another really, if you want to look at the really extreme example, just to make it highlighted, is a kind of like manic depression. You know, the kind of, and I could see it in my own mind, especially when I was growing up, there's a kind of like a manic depression, which is, I don't think I was manic depressive, but there's a sense that, you kind of get into this excited frame of reference for yourself. You kind of think, oh, I'm really great. I'm really doing all these things, you know, and things are going really well. And you get really excited. And then there's always the fall from that. And there's a kind of a downer. And then there's a going back up, and then going back down, and going back up. And this experience goes on and on and on. You know, that's experience. That's just your life. That's a life. And in our society, oftentimes, we identify with that. I think that's who we are and what our life is about. So when Buddhism, I think it changes our framework altogether to say, okay, I'm going to say, not to say that framework you're using is not what you can use. You can use that if you like. But let me give you another framework. This framework I'm giving you will actually have you find a lasting happiness and reduce your suffering at a very deep level and ultimately arrive at complete liberation and profound wisdom. And so he says, okay, so use this framework. What's this framework I'm giving you? Well, use it, for instance, the 12 conditioned links to say, wherever I seek for excitement or go out seeking for something, that's where I need to be really cautious. And for instance, if you have a Dharma method, like reciting the Buddha's name or reciting Guanyin Bodhisattva's name or the Great Compassion Mantra, I would say, do that all the time. So actually, that was one of the other things I really liked about Buddhism was, for my mind, which is overly active and actually gets bored very easily, for me to really see the importance of recitation allowed me not to ever really get bored, because we can always recite. So if you're stuck, you know, in a boring situation, remember to recite. Namo Guanshin Busa, Namo Guanshin Busa. And in your mind, you can know, even the Buddha's teachings, every single recitation that you do with real sincerity and single-minded focus is planting the seed and creating the conditions for future freedom. So that's happening every single moment. So we don't want to waste a single moment. So there's no time to be bored. You have so much, you have a lot of work to do in every existential moment of your mind. So there's no space to be bored. So that really works for me. So for me to know that and believe that really sincerely, then whenever I get bored, I have an experience of that, I go, wait a moment, what's going on? I'm wasting my time. I better get back to my recitation because this is a really important thing I'm supposed to be doing with given my precious human existence. So that's what I would say, is that if you start doing that, what I would say is that actually levels out your life and things become much more simple and stable and actually much more happy. You have a much more abiding happiness that's not based on excitement. Yeah. Okay, so we have a movie, Highway 9. I don't know if I should say it's exciting or not. And that maybe not so exciting. So as I said, just to give context, there's a monastery down in Santa Cruz area, actually near Boulder Creek. We call this monastery Highway 9 because it's on Highway 9. We're still looking for a better name. If people have ideas for it, please share. I think we were just brainstorming in the monastery last week or 2 weeks ago. School there? Oh. Yeah. Oh, what's the name of the school? I don't know what the name of the school is. But basically, So, down a little bit more. Or 1 foot. So we thought of something maybe Redwood Chan Monastery or Redwood Hermitage, Redwood Forest Hermitage. So we're thinking. Redwood. Jing Fo sure is thinking in Chinese it would be Hongmu Chanling. Hongmu, Hong is red, Mu is wood, Chan is Chan or Zen, Ling is forest. So Ling oftentimes in Chinese culture means monastery as well. You go to a monastery which is a Da Chan Ling, a great forest. Actually the image is, they say the monastery is like a forest, ideally a great forest because you have all the trees. And when there's all these trees growing in the forest, they're all very straight. You can't, if you're in the forest, you can't grow crooked because you're going to hit another tree. So that's like the good friends, right, in the monastery. Everybody's growing straight. You can't grow crooked or you crash into your neighbor. Push enter. Okay, good.
我们现在打观音机，我们就用观音大师画红莲，因为我们以后那个是一个红木莲啊，红莲就是红木莲。
So that's, you changed the screen. Okay, yeah. So this is Guanyin Bodhisattva. Great, the sage Guanyin Bodhisattva is there to transform the redwood forest. It's the Chinese. So it's the Guanyin Bodhisattva. Oh.
后面这个是那个果真的他的家.
That's Guanyin's house. So we changed locations.
Okay.
This jumps around a lot. This is them, I guess, transforming it into a redwood Chan monastery. So then the machine was actually a new weed whacker. So this is, they're doing Dharma instruments there too. It's not just in Berkeley, they have Dharma instruments now in Highway 9 as well. A lot of flowers. Look at that, this is the altar there. Jing Fo has been spending a lot of time there.
Okay.
He's always going there all the time.
刚才那个.
Oh, I think pause is not spacebar. Yeah, you should use another software. I think if you use the other software, it'll be here. Escape. Push this to play. Okay. So this is the this is their another okay. place. This is cleaning up Highway 9.
Yeah, that Phil and Mr. Yap. So now we use machine. CDTV have a couple people go to their help, Gohin and Chimin. So this is we clean up the Buddha hall in the south side, close to the mountain side. And this is the new machine. This is a very good machine, like, you know, very easy handle.
So they're weeding the
weeding
the place, so it's going to be used in the future.
Okay, that you see that have a
Dharma instruments.
We practice in there every night.
This is
Buddha hall. And
that
is the new one, that the new the stove and that warm up food there too. So we can any lunchtime, so when morning prepare there, lunchtime already, you know, can eat. So they're very good one. This is Gojen, the new set bought. He bought a new set.
They're very frugal there, actually. So
yeah,
they just don't use a stove at all. They kept telling me they don't use the stove at all. They just end up using the stove. I mean, they don't use the normal stove. They just use the wood stove for their food. So that's just their whole lunch is there. They just put everything in there. They steam it, and that's their food.
This is a Buddha hall too. So that is one side. And this is a chainsaw, new one. This is a who? Twig?
It is a
the girl?
Yeah.
And this is we also buy the chainsaw. The long can be very longer.
This is to trim all the trees, because in the forest there's a lot of trees in the area. So they're
fear to trim the tree.
Go up. I believe you put a little paper on each tree, right? One of the traditions in the monastery is that we always let the trees know that we're going to trim the tree. So they say tree spirits, you know, to adorn the way place, you know, we need to trim the tree at this time. If you need to move house, please move house.
We have to filter the.
Oh, adding a filter?
Yeah, so we
water
don't need
filter.
To, yeah.
Adding a water filter.
Already set up now.
So they have a water filter now?
Eric
set it up.
Okay, this is
there.
A new toy, the big toy.
A new toy. They borrowed it from the city.
Yeah.
Yeah, it tills the land.
Yeah. We can grow in vegetable there too.
Jingpo wants to start a farm, start a little garden there. I believe Jingpo has an agriculture background. He said the agriculture before. So he used to do farming. Say again? Oh boy. Jingpo. Oh, they made steps. This is actually
we make a step, go up.
And people know the way you get to the back door, before you had to like jump onto the side and climb up the thing so that you could get up there. But now they actually made steps, which is very nice, because otherwise you can't really get up there. Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
So there's the steps.
Yeah, let it go up. Okay. We see have the red line there, that is from the sun. So, we don't, that is, we take camera there.
So this is just, you get to see the, I guess the stairways up in the back that door. Actually, that's our front door. That's on the back. It's a very strange building.
Close the mountain side. That is south side. Yeah.
Yeah. So you can see the forest around. The redwood forest. So people can think this is like Buddha Root Farm. You always go to Buddha Root Farm, but this is much closer. This is about from here, it's about an hour and a half, but from the Bay Area, it's about 30 minutes. From San Jose and Saratoga, about 30, 45 minutes. As a kid growing up, I used to camp out in this area quite a bit. This is the main place that Boy Scouts go and camp out at, in this park area, big basin. Castle Rock State Park.
You see the green line, the red, green, that is from the sun. Yeah, the lights from there.
That's not a magical ray.
So I don't
coming from a laser beam shining down on.
Okay, this is a Highway 9 on the way to. Yeah.
On the way to Highway 9?
Yeah.
Oh, this is on the way. This is the view on the way to Highway 9.
You see that is a very song, the sun shut down.
The sun flare on the lens, and that's what it's called.
So,
I think it's a flare on the lens. So you need a lens with a light that shines on it, and it creates a...
But when they have that kind, they have a different song, that Bible, like it.
Yeah. It's definitely a cheap camera.
Cheap camera. Yeah. Very beautiful air.
Hey, fresh air.
Yeah.
Yeah, and the forest is really nice because you have a lot of oxygen. I think we don't really notice, but... when you're actually in the forest, you go, wow, this is actually how air is supposed to be like. This is like the air that we usually breathe is not like the forest. I always feel like I maybe like double the energy in the forest and out in this kind of city-like area.
Since you know, it happened that too. So maybe camera too cheap, so I don't know.
Heaven. What are we looking at? The clouds?
I don't know. That, you know, that lecture looks
like a lecture.
I don't know what it is.
So yeah, if people are interested, I think Jing Forsh is actually going down to Highway 9 quite a lot. We're doing a lot of work down there, and so if people are interested, you can go
okay, in. This is Jing Chuan's mom helped to Pai Wei last time, you know, so.
Yeah. Right, the Pai Weis. Okay. Oh, you've paused on the white screen.
One more
screen. Okay.
So that is tonight the topic, you know. So like a Guanyin section, and they like a very protected Chanin there, and also we can learn in 12 Lin. Then you know everything, then you're really freedom.
Free. You're real free. So the Chinese says, you know, you don't want you to.
Yeah.
观音大士受禅林了却因缘真自由. So this is a verse Jing Forsher wrote for this time, for this main topic for this slideshow, is 观音大士, which we said before, the great sage 观音 Bodhisattva. Gathers in, or you could say maybe helps at this Chan Forest Monastery. For us to understand the 12 conditioned links, that will let us find true freedom and liberation. Yeah. Literally, 自由, real freedom. we'll have real freedom.
Okay, it's tonight.
Okay, so that's our presentation for tonight. Okay. Yeah, Gene Fosher is becoming a movie maker. Wow, I never knew. So, for the end of the sutra lecture, actually, is there any other last questions or thoughts people have? Any online? We have, let's see, tomorrow we have the Amitabha recitation for one day. So if people are interested, please come. We start at 7:30 and we go all the way to 5 o'clock. But if you would like to come anytime during that time, please feel free to join us. So that's the Amitabha walking recitation tomorrow. The reason we moved it to this Sunday was because of the Guanyin session. So we didn't want a conflict with the Guanyin session, so we're having it on the second Sunday this month. Otherwise, we have our classes as usual all of next week. I believe we're going to have the Buddhism for the Modern Mind this Monday. And we also have the beginner's class for Buddhism on Thursday. I've been doing that on Thursdays with people. So if people know of friends who would like to be introduced to Buddhism in a much more, kind of a very, you could say, the word's not exactly simple, but I would say it's in a kind of modern way for young people. That's on Thursday night. Yeah. Okay. Otherwise, all the classes as normal are still happening. Friday, Marty has his class on the Six Patriarch. Thursday, we have also a Spirit Rock or the East Bay Insight Meditation. Wednesday, Stephen Tanner teaches his class. And that's our schedule. Okay, so if no one has any other questions, we have our Dedication of Merit, which is on the back of your Dharma request sheet. It says Dedication of Merit. If it's the first time you're here in the monastery, the principle behind Dedication of Merit is that here we're studying the Dharma together, and in a way it has a very bland flavor. But actually the Buddha says the Dharma is beautiful in the beginning, beautiful in the middle, beautiful in the end. It's good throughout. And you cultivate it, it's good the moment you start practicing it, it's good in the middle of you practicing it, and it's good at the final goal. So it's good throughout. And so we have this goodness that we can share with other people, and so that's what Dedication of Merit is. It's basically taking the Dharma that we've learned and the goodness that we've cultivated and sending it out to living beings, wherever they may be, in whatever way we like. Okay.
Because our hearts are one,
This world of pain turns into paradise. May all become compassionate and wise. May all become compassionate and wise. We can all stand to bow to the Buddhas. Okay, three bows. Bow in respect to the Venerable Master. Namodavang Wangvo Wayen.